Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the American Enterprise Institute. My name is Robert Doerr, and I'm very happy to welcome you to this discussion of Naomi Schaefer Riley's important book, The New Trail of Tears: How Washington is Destroying American Indians. Today's discussion is another in a long series we have done here at AEI on our nation's struggling populations. AEI's Poverty Studies program has produced research on a variety of issues concerning poor Americans, including work on employment, disability, family, and our major federal safety net programs. Today, we focus on Native Americans who have poverty rates well above the national average and suffer high rates of crime, alcohol abuse, and suicide. And we have an excellent group of subject matter experts to participate in this discussion. We will begin with Naomi Schaefer Riley. Naomi is a weekly columnist for the New York Post and a former Wall Street Journal editor and writer whose work focuses on higher education, religion, philanthropy, and culture. She is the author of 6 books, including The New Trail of Tears: How Washington is Destroying American Indians. After Naomi speaks, we will hear from Chairman Congressman Robert Bishop of Utah. Congressman Bishop is serving his 7th term as representative for Utah's 1st District. Formerly, he was the state chairman of the Republican Party and worked for 16 years in the state legislature, including as majority leader and speaker of the House. He also spent 28 years as a high school teacher in Utah, focusing on American history and government. In addition to serving on the House Armed Services Committee as a member of the Readiness Subcommittee, Representative Bishop is chairman of the House Committee on Natural Resources. And then we will have a panel discussion and bring in 2 prominent experts on the issue who I will introduce later. So let's begin with Naomi. Thank you.
I want to thank you all for coming out today, and especially thank the congressman for being willing to devote some time to this today. I recently pitched an op-ed on the subject of changing some policies with regard to Indians. And the editor wrote me back saying, oh, I think it's a good idea, but you should know you're pitching it one of the busiest news cycles of all time. And I said, OK. And he said, so you'll have to be patient. I said, I understand. And I can be patient, but I think a lot of the people who are affected by the policies we're going to discuss today really have run out of patience, and rightly so. So with that, I'll start. About 3,000 people live in Manderson, South Dakota. Manderson is in the middle of the Pine Ridge Reservation, which makes up most of the second poorest county in the United States. In 2013, the 5 police officers assigned to patrol the area received 16,500 calls for emergency assistance. Now, I want to take a minute for all of you to do the math. 3,000 people, 16,500 calls, 5 police officers. As of 2009, there were 39 gangs on the Pine Ridge Reservation, involving more than 5,000 young men. The average life expectancy for men on the reservation is 48. Pine Ridge is one of the worst reservations, but the nationwide statistics, unfortunately, are not much better. American Indians have the highest rate of poverty of any racial group in the country. High school graduation is around 50% and has actually fallen in recent years. Suicide is the leading cause of death for Native American males aged 10 to 14. Alcohol use disorders are more likely among American Indian youth than those belonging to other racial groups. Involvement in gang activity is more prevalent among Native Americans than it is for Latinos or African Americans. Native women report being raped at 2.5 times the national average, and the rate of child abuse among Native Americans is twice as high as the national average. An estimated 1 out of every 4 girls and 1 out of every 6 boys in Indian country is molested before the age of 18. If you want to understand what is behind these statistics, you have to visit Indian territories. And a couple of years ago, that is what I did. I spent some time visiting the elementary school in Manderson. It's called Wounded Knee, and it recently received $600,000 in turnaround funds from the federal government. It is clean, freshly painted, and mostly quiet in the halls. They've installed a computer room to reward kids for good behavior and laundry machines so that local parents will have an incentive to come meet with the teachers. Academically, though, it's pretty appalling. As I stood there, the principal, Alice Phelps, offered to help a 2nd grade student with 2 math problems. She gave the boy incorrect answers to both of them. Phelps had recently fired the entire staff and rehired only those teachers who had not come from Teach for America. Despite the fact that some had math degrees from Ivy League schools, Phelps felt that they were not the right fit for her school. Other tribal leaders were much more explicit with me, telling me that the TFA folks were simply too white. But in Manderson, it must be said that the school's first job is just to keep the children safe. Phelps occasionally called the police when students got violent, but mostly their problems are not serious enough to actually merit a police response. So the school has learned how to handle matters on its own. One weekend a month, Phelps tells me, "We have lock-in." "Lock-in?" I asked, wondering what these innocent-looking kids have done to deserve such punishment. "Lock-in is not punishment," she assures me. "It's when the children stay at school all weekend for their safety." Although the weekend is actually billed as a cultural enrichment event for the children, they sing songs and play traditional games in the school's gym, Phelps tells me that it is time to coincide with when government checks go out. These are the times they know when parents will be most likely to drink and become abusive. The rhythm of life at Wounded Knee on Pine Ridge and for the over 1 million Native Americans living on reservations is surprisingly dependent on the federal government. To know just how much the economy depends on the reservation depends on public funds, one need only look at the effects that the federal government shutdown in 2013 had on reservations. Take the Crow tribe. Some 364 Crow members, more than a third of the tribe's workforce, was furloughed. A bus service, the only way some Crows are able to travel to and from across their 2.3 million acre reservation, was shuttered, and a home health care program was suspended. The Yurok tribe in Northern California relies almost solely on federal financing to operate. Its reservation has an 80% unemployment rate. I submitted that in another op-ed recently, and an editor wrote me back saying, "No, you mean an 80% employment rate." And I said, "No, I do not." As a result of the shutdown, the tribe furloughed 60 of its 310 employees, closed its child care center, and halted emergency funding assistance to low-income and older members. Financing for a program that ensures clean drinking water on the reservation ran low as well. These tribes are so dependent on the federal government that without money from the BIA, their economic activity comes to a complete halt, and their members may not have access to clean drinking water. There is a third world country that exists in the middle of the wealthiest nation on Earth. The question is, how did we get here? Reservations, of course, most people know, were formed as a way to get Indians out of the way, to push natives onto infertile or otherwise undesirable plots of land so that Americans could pursue westward expansion. Today, though, a surprising number of people seem to view reservations as a way of protecting Native Americans, of ensuring that no one can take anything away from them. Reservation land is held, quote, in trust for Indians by the federal government. The only other people that we legally hold things in trust for are children and the mentally incompetent. So it's pretty shameful that in 2017, this is the way we talk about our Indian policy. The goal of this policy was originally to keep Indians contained, and now it has shifted to preserving lands for indigenous people. But the effect is the same. Indians can't own this land. No one on a reservation can get a mortgage because the property on the reservation is held in trust by the federal government. Most of it is also owned communally by the tribe. No bank could ever foreclose on a property because the bank cannot own reservation land. Despite millions of acres of empty space, there is a severe housing shortage on many reservations. More and more family members crowd into small trailer homes. But this is only part of the problem. More than a quarter of small business owners in the U.S. use home equity loans to start up a small business or finance an existing one. American Indians do not have access to this capital. They don't own their land, so they don't own their homes, so they can't use their homes as equity. Indians have long suffered from what the Nobel Prize-winning economist Hernando de Soto has called dead capital. They may possess a certain amount of land on paper, but they can't put it to use by selling it, buying more to take advantage of economies of scale, or borrowing against it. Indian reservations may have once thought to be useless, but that is no longer the case. In fact, they contain almost 30% of the nation's coal reserves west of the Mississippi, 50% of potential uranium reserves, and 20% of known oil and gas reserves. These are resources worth nearly $1.5 trillion, or $290,000 per tribal member. Tragically, 86% of Indian lands with energy or mineral potential remain undeveloped because of federal control of reservations.
In order to tap into those reserves, Indians must follow a 49-step process, as one Crow legislator explained to me. These steps involve the Bureau of Land Management, the Department of Interior, the Department of Justice, and the Commerce Department. And it can take months, if not years, for each step to be approved. Just to dig a hole requires a $6,500 upfront payment for an application for a permit to drill. If you walk a few steps off the reservation, you'll find that permit cost you $125. The bureaucracy that oversees reservations is mind-boggling. The BIA has 9,000 employees. That is one employee for every 111 Indians on a reservation. And as with all bureaucrats, they need to find something to do. One Indian man I spoke to was trying to purchase land, a few acres, from a neighbor in order to graze some of his cattle. The two had agreed on a price, but then a representative of the BIA came and told them that the deal couldn't go through because the price they had agreed on was not, quote, fair market value. In the real world, of course, fair market value is what someone will actually pay you, but not in the world of the BIA. The agency had recently commissioned an appraisal of land on the reservation and told the appraiser to overvalue the land so as not to, quote, screw the Indians, which is, of course, exactly what happened. It's no wonder Indians say that BIA stands for bossing Indians around. But what about the casinos? I am regularly asked by people, can't Indians make enough money off of gambling to claw their way out of poverty? Most Indian casinos are dinky affairs in isolated communities, and sadly, their only other customers are other Indians. But even the successful ones actually don't bring the prosperity you might expect. The Senecas in upstate New York, for instance, have made over $1 billion off of their gaming operations in the past decade or so. Those profits are distributed to tribe members in the form of annuities. According to Lucille Brooks, who runs the Seneca Economic Development Company, the annuities have, quote, created an entitlement attitude, and that is the downfall. The annuities have enabled people not to work. Now that more and more states are opening up gambling to non-Indians, tribes are facing more and more competition. The Seneca, in order to diversify their holdings, has offered low or no interest business loans to anyone who wants to try some other business. Michael John, the manager of the Small Business Incubator Program on the territory, says his group conducted a survey to find out which businesses residents should open. He tells people there are too many pizza places around, and instead he recommended either outdoor recreation, maintenance, landscaping, or professional massage. You do not have to go to Beijing to see central planning at work. The economic outlook on reservations is bleak. Indians have no real private property, no access to capital for building businesses, little ability to develop their own natural resources, and often no incentive to work. We give them regulatory and tax advantages like gaming, alcohol, tobacco, and now even marijuana. Because who wouldn't want these in your backyard, right? But even those don't help them because the industries are all collectively owned by the tribes and the profits are distributed like lottery winnings or welfare checks, depending on your perspective. More money is not the answer. Washington sends about $20 billion a year to reservations. The Indian Health Service, for instance, had a budget in 2015 of $4.6 billion, and it is perhaps the last place in the country you would want to go see a doctor. The BIE spends about $20,000 per pupil compared to a national average of $12,400. Not only do the schools fail in most cases to educate their students, but even the roofs are caving in. The BIE has gone through 34 directors in 36 years. And more cultural sensitivity is unlikely to do the trick either. After the media launched a national campaign to get the owner of the Washington Redskins to change his team's name, the Washington Post, of course, did a survey and found out that 9 out of 10 Indians couldn't care less about the name of the team, which is not surprising. If your community was facing an epidemic of adolescent suicide, would NFL mascots be at the top of your list? The tragedy of American Indian policies demands immediate examination, not only because they make the lives of millions of American citizens harder and more dangerous, but also because they are a microcosm of everything that has gone wrong, I think, with modern liberalism. They are the result of decades of politicians and bureaucrats showering a victimized people with money and sensitivity instead of what they truly need, the autonomy, the education, and the legal protections to improve their own situations. American Indians, like all Americans, must be able to avail themselves of the economic and legal freedoms that this country guarantees. Until then, they will remain mired in poverty, social pathology, and the kind of anger that comes from knowing that your fate is controlled by ill-informed and ineffective bureaucracies. The solutions here are not easy, and we will be discussing them more on this panel, but they could start with education. The states that have the largest Indian populations are some of the only ones left in this country with no charter laws. These children have no alternative to places like Wounded Knee because no one is allowed to offer them. We could start to scale back some of the regulation in Washington, and I'm sure the congressman will talk about that, allowing Indians to develop natural resources without having to pass everything through the BIA. Some legislators are, of course, working to curb that power now. But ultimately, it will be very hard to undo this economic disaster without real property rights. A number of tribes in Canada, for instance, are pushing legislation called the First Nations Property Ownership Act, which would create the legal framework for individual members of First Nations to access capital through secure property rights. They see reserve land, which is very similar to our reservations, as becoming more like cities. Even if the land were bought or sold, it would remain part of the city, just as no one can buy or sell a part of New York City to Newark. But individuals of any race would be able to buy it and sell it among themselves without the permission or oversight of tribal or federal officials. This would allow for a true free market. First Nations members who wanted to lease their land for the development of natural resources would be able to do so without seeking permission. And those who wanted to sell their property would be able to select the highest bidder, regardless of race, take that money and put it to use for themselves and their families. And finally, those who wanted to keep their land would be able to borrow against it to build a home or start their own business. As one Lumbee Indian from North Carolina told me, "The only solution I see is divide everything up and give it to the Native American family and let them disperse it, spend it, keep it, whatever. I don't need no government taking care of me." This kind of freedom, he said, that's why the pilgrims left Europe. Thank you very much.
Okay. Don't go across the stage because you'll trip. That's a long jump across. Please be okay. Okay, good.
Thank you very much for the opportunity and the invitation to be here. Actually, I don't appreciate following Naomi. She did a great job, and she knows what she's talking about. Unfortunately, I'm just going to be blubbering along here. So I apologize for that in advance. But I appreciate her broaching this issue because it's a significant issue, significant topic. It needs to be discussed. And I hope I appreciate that outlook that comes from it. If I could say one thing about the policy that we have had in this nation towards Native Americans, it's failing. The status quo does not work, and there needs to be some kind of significant change. If I look at what I think the last administration has done on Native American policy, what they did was not necessarily bad, but it wasn't really good either. It was a lot more lip service than actual reality. And even though the fundings for BIA was increased significantly, the job index for Native Americans did not increase. Unemployment did not decrease significantly. The administration is supposed to give Congress every 2 years a report on Native American population and employment. First effort for doing that was 6 years late. The data was 3 years old. It was totally useless as far as anything that we could use. And the claims that the report made did not reflect the reality of what was actually taking place in Indian country. Same time with healthcare, even though since 2008, the amount of money spent on Indian healthcare has increased by almost 50%, it still has resulted in shortages of care, shortages of equipment, incompetence that has taken place in Native hospitals, and the cliche that is now being given that if you're gonna get sick before June, because by June they've run through the money and they don't have anything to give you anymore. Those are the problems that simply have to be there. So in my estimation, after having served 2 years as the chairman of this committee that has jurisdiction on Native American issues, I think it's really time for a paradigm shift. It is time to look differently at the relationships we have, the nation has, and Congress has with tribes. That the idea that we have, that I see right now with the Bureau of Indian Affairs is one based on paternalism. When I can have a BIA director come in front of my committee and say, that he speaks for Indian country. That is not just hubris. It is tremendously disallowing the fact that Native Americans are not a monolithic group that all thinks and does works the same way. That indeed, programs for one tribe may be a deficit and a harm to another tribe. And that's good, because that's the way life actually should be, and that we should be dealing with this not as the one policy we have for all Indian country as a one-size-fits-all from Washington, even though we're wont to doing that all the time, but we should try to do things individually for those. In fact, the paradigm shift that I would hope would take place is one that would allow more freedom for Native American tribes to be self-interested and to respect what their self-interests take place. As was stated already here, you know, property of tribes is not necessarily their tribe. It's a trust that is for them, which means they are subject to the same kind of constrictions and results as some of the Americans are. Look, for example, the vending and flaring rule that was passed at the last minute, unfortunately and hopefully will be revoked this week, that had devastating impacts for tribes who have energy production and resource production as their fundamental means of making money. In fact, it encourages industry to invest in non-native lands over native lands. That's one of the problems. We recently had a Bear's Ears monument created in my state, something for which I am still happy about. But when the Commissioner Benally, who has actually made a unique mark in Utah, she is the first female Native American commissioner in Utah history, and she and her others came to us and said, let's create this area known as Bear's Ears, which abuts the San Juan County Navajo Reservation, for traditional and religious practices. But they want specific and unique practices. They want to be able to go in and collect wood and drive in their trucks, things that are not normally assigned to BLM property and can only be established by law. In fact, they also said, why not give us the opportunity of managing and making decisions on how these lands will be managed so that we can actually produce those religious and traditional activities, which is once again something you can't do in law right now. It would have to be rewritten. Unfortunately, when the monument was designated, instead of giving them this co-management approach, a commission would be established under the president's declaration that would allow them to give suggestions to BLM which could or could not be listened to. In fact, in most cases, they wouldn't, because in other monuments, other groups that have had these commissions, they haven't been heard by the Department of Interior either. Those are the types of things that we want to do. In fact, this monument to me seems to indicate how the federal government seems to want to do PR for groups of people who do not necessarily live in those areas, and they put that above traditional practices that would be respected by people who actually live in those particular areas. The hydraulic fracking rule went into effect, even though it was supposed to legally have coordination and consultation with tribes. It took place with one of my tribes not knowing it happened, not knowing anything about it until after the rule had actually been promulgated, without any kind of consultation taking place. There are a whole lot of areas, especially in my state, where there is no gambling that's legally permitted, in which gaming is not a source of revenue for Native American tribes, and resources are their only value for doing that, and yet they are prohibited from doing that. And throughout this nation, we see where Native Americans can do a great deal better if we give them the freedom to actually work for themselves. So the Native American tribes in Washington have great force, and they need to develop that for the lumber byproducts if we allow them to do it. The Navajo Reservation could have developed the largest clean coal-burning plant in this nation, but EPA rejected that even after it had been granted earlier on. The Southern Utes in Colorado, for example, are great in the area of energy production and resource management. But the federal government has this program for land recording called TAMS, which tells them where the leases are, who owns them, how much money, the revenue they're going, everything else. The TAMS project is a terrible program. It's expensive, we're always trying to fix it, it flat out doesn't work. The Southern Ute tribe came up with their own approach, their own program to do this, even though the local BIA officials were happy about it. Washington refused to allow them to go forward with their own program that does the work better and more efficiently because it wasn't TAMS. There is no real reason for doing that. And the letter we sent to the Secretary of Interior protesting this on behalf of the Southern Ute Tribe still has yet to be responded. there is nothing that should be going there. In fact, as Aliquin from the tribe said, the best thing you could do for that tribe is simply to get out of the way. I've heard that from other groups. It also works for Native Americans at the same time. So as a policy issue, we passed last year a Native American Energy Act. I hope we do it again, which tries to streamline the process of regulations and allowing Native Americans to develop the resources they have faster and more efficiently and effectively without having roadblocks and red tape thrown in their path every step of the way. We passed a Native American Health Act, which I hope we redo again, which simply goes back to try and solidify some of these practices that are being there, including coming up with a demonstration project, at least a demonstration project, which allows Native Americans to actually control the hospital and control the medical care and giving them that kind of opportunity. I also hope to pass the Tribal Recognition Act, which simply says if new tribes are going to be recognized, there has to be a standard, and that standard should be for all areas, and that should not be political. And now, this sounds strange because I'm saying use the political process to create tribal recognition. If you think BIA recognizes tribes now without being political, that's crazy talk. There is nothing true to that whatsoever. And in fact, we can give some examples, especially with reports done by the Inspector General that shows how that has been truly politicized and indeed in some shady particular ways. Stake that so there is a logical way of doing it. Like, I am one of the advocates of federalism for this nation, because to me, federalism is what the founders envisioned originally taking place. Federalism is neither Republican or Democrat. It's not conservative or liberal. In fact, there may be some areas that want robust government, and if those areas, if New Jersey wants to have a whole bunch of state government and they're willing to pay for it, let them do it. Just don't make me have to follow under those same categories. That concept of federalism to me also applies to reservations. Give them the opportunity to make decisions for themselves, and if I don't like what those decisions are, fine. Just so that they make sure that they have the ability of succeeding on their own or failing on their own, but they have the ability of doing that. The principles of freedom would work good for government, whether that freedom involves states making decisions for themselves or tribes making decisions for themselves. But at one side, we've got to get over this paternalistic attitude that only the federal government, only people here in Washington can make the proper decisions on how people run their lives. That's an overarching philosophy that I hope comes in there. Commissioner Benally, who is, as I said, the first female Native American commissioner in speaking out against a Bears Ears monument, actually made some very poignant parts. And in talking to some of the groups that were proposing it, she simply said, I'm here to tell you to stop romanticizing and stop pretending. And stop pretending that you're doing this for Native American people. I've seen it time and time again. It's wrong. And I'm tired of you using my people, talking for them. Maybe that's exactly what we need to do. That attitude is what we need to do in here. And I appreciate the opportunity of hearing the report about it, the book about it, because I think it opens up a great many discussion elements to it. And I'm looking forward to trying to bring that same paradigm shift back into Washington as this new administration comes up with new policies towards Native Americans, but one that emphasizes the ability of respecting, giving them ability to make decisions for themselves, and giving them the freedom to make those decisions for themselves without pre-existing conditions, without red tape, without restrictions coming back from the federal government. With that, I thank you. I thank you for actually, I'll leave with the one last, my favorite quote of all times, and I apologize for this, because I know I can see, I was a teacher for 28 years. I know that's that look in your eyes. I've seen you, you're glazing over here. My favorite quote was still done by Huey Long when he was elected as a speaker, as a senator from Louisiana. And he came up here to Washington, they went back on his first break, and the people asked Long if all the talking in Washington bothered him. And he said, no, the talking doesn't bother me. It's the listening that bores the hell out of me. And I'm sorry that I've just put you in the position of the listener for the last 15 minutes. I apologize for that. But thank you for your time, Nathan.
Thank you very much. Okay, Keith, come on up. Yes. We have Keith here and Chris there. Representative Bishop, you're there, and then Naomi's at the end. Thank you very much. My eyes didn't glaze over. I thought there was a lot of passion and a lot of detail and a lot of good presentation from both Naomi and from Chairman Bishop, and I want to thank you both very much. Now we're going to get into two responses to Naomi's work. from Keith Moore and from Chris Edwards. And we're going to begin. I'm going to introduce them both. And then, Keith, I'm going to give you a little time to talk about how you react to what you've heard and what you've read in Naomi's book. And then to you, Chris. And then I hope we can have a dialogue and a discussion about some of the issues that have been raised. So Keith is a member of the Rosebud Sioux Tribe. He has served as a classroom teacher, coach, school administrator, Indian Education Director for South Dakota's Department of Education, Chief Diversity Officer for the University of South Dakota, and most recently, Director of the Bureau of Indian Education. He is currently serving as the State Director for the Fellowship of Christian Athletes in South Dakota. Chris Edwards is the Director of Tax Policy Studies at Cato. He is a top expert on federal and state tax and budget issues, and before joining Cato, he was a senior economist on the Congressional Joint Economic Committee, a manager with PricewaterhouseCoopers, and an economist with the Tax Foundation. So let's start with you, Keith. Well, how do you react to what you've heard and from your own experience? Well,
take it away. First of all, let me thank Naomi for writing the book. It takes a lot of courage to take on this topic, and I appreciate her writing the book in the first place, so thanks a lot, Naomi. I'd also like to thank the American Enterprise Institute for the invite and also hosting the forum on this topic. And then quickly, a little more of my personal background. I grew up on the Rosebud Indian Reservation until I was 8 years old. My mom was full-blood Native. My dad was an Irishman and grew up in a community adjacent to the reservation. So when we left the reservation, we moved to that community, and it had a huge impact on me because it was a middle-class community. It was a community where I got to meet friends that had different hopes and dreams, and I got to see people who thrived economically, and that had a huge impact on me when I got older. I also grew up with pretty darn good teachers and administrators, which is huge, as Naomi laid out for you in her remarks, when you don't have that and what it means for you. I was also part of abuse statistics when I grew up on the reservation, and obviously, that had a huge impact on me as I grew older. But when I grew up in the border community, there was one thing that really made a difference for me, and it was sports. I was looked at as an outsider for a number of years and wanted to make friends and couldn't. And when I became good at sports, like a lot of small rural towns in South Dakota, that was a big deal. And for the first time I made friends, it's really what drove me and propelled me to college. I went to college on an athletic scholarship. And then after that, added a couple graduate degrees in secondary administration and specialist in educational leadership. So like the congressman, a lot of years in education, eventually the state Indian Ed director position, which had a profound impact on me. And then my opportunity to come to DC had a really deep impact on me because, like they've shared here, I got here with the hope of an Indian kid in South Dakota rising from poverty and nothing to a leadership role that I really thought I could make a difference in. And when I got here, I realized that wasn't the case. The deep bureaucracy, the deep regulation, just what a government can do to a people when it's as oppressive as we've lived under, is something that just holds you down and holds you back. And as much as it hurt me, I left the role of the BIE director and went home. I now run a nonprofit where day to day, we raise money and we can do what we want. We can change our course of action within a nonprofit organization like you cannot in a bureaucracy. And it serves communities, it serves the state, and if you aren't doing what people that are supporting you, the supporters and donors, is what's gonna hold you back. So what I've heard today is really what we all know is the truth. People want, as the congressman said, freedom in Indian country. We need autonomy in Indian country. The land issue is, in my opinion, a big issue for us and a tough one to get through. More land into trust, in my opinion, is not it's not going to solve our issue. It's about individual Indian rights, ability to own land, which creates wealth for individuals and able to move them forward. I'm an example of owned a little piece of land. When I grew up, the vacation for us was the Black Hills of South Dakota. And from a little guy going out there, I thought, someday I'm going to own property here. Someday. I didn't know what that meant at the time. I just knew I wanted to do that. And I bought a little cabin. I taught and coached out there, and I bought a little cabin that when I bought it, I bought for $29,000. My wife and I, who's here with me, Christy, we just sold that piece of land to put into our primary home for our five daughters, and it sold for $115,000. And that was the difference, being able to afford the home and move that into that home and move forward in terms of wealth. I just see that in a small way, and know that that's one of the critical issues for us in Indian countries. How do we increase individual Indian rights, the ability to own land, the ability to start businesses is really a critical issue. So as I wrap up today, I'd just like to say that as an educator, both living on and off the reservation, this is, the policies here are, they're just so important of where we go as we move forward. You've seen the what's happened with the longstanding policy that we have. And when I went to the Department of Education, directed the Indian office there, the Indian Educational Office, I said to the Secretary of Education, let's do something different, even if it's wrong. Because currently what we're doing is clearly wrong. And try to take the steps to do something new that can open up new doors and provide opportunity to the Indian kids. So as I wrap up today, this is a critical issue for us out in Indian country. We need new policy, we need deep thinking, we need thoughtful thinkers, we need strategic thinking in order to move Indian country forward. And we need freedom, and we need autonomy to do that.
Thank you very much. So Chris, you wrap us, take it from there.
Oh, thank you very much. I'm really honored to be here at AEI talking about this really super important issue that's often ignored in Washington. I love Naomi's book. It's really great. I'd highly recommend it to everyone. You know, I got interested in these issues because I studied federal bureaucracy and federal agencies, and frankly, there's nothing as bureaucratic as the BIA. You know, I'm like Naomi, I'm, you know, appalled at the failure of federal policies over many decades, the poverty on Indian reservations. So my strongest, you know, sense about Indian policy is just sort of a general disgust that these fundamental problems with institutions have been ongoing decade after decade without a solution by Congress. Let me just briefly touch on two things. First is the bureaucracy problem with the BIA, and the other is the economic development problem that Naomi touched on and some of the other speakers. So the BIA is 2 centuries old, and it's suffered from mismanagement and failure the entire time. It's really remarkable. I'm going to give you a few quotes from history to sort of give you a sense at how long these problems have been going on. Let's start way back in 1834. The congressional report said that BIA's, quote, administration is inexpensive, inefficient, and irresponsible. In 1868, editorial by the New York Times lambasted BIA corruption, saying dishonesty pervades the whole bureau. In 1915, a congressional report warned that the BIA suffered from, quote, fraud, corruption, and institutional incompetence almost beyond the possibility of comprehension, they said. 2002, more recently, the federal judge handling the BIA trust fund lawsuit said, quote, the BIA has served as the gold standard for mismanagement by the federal government for more than a century. More recently, 2011, the Inspector General for the Department of Interior complained about, quote, the gross program inefficiencies at many levels of Indian affairs and tribal mismanagement of federal funds. So, you know, these bureaucratic problems are important because the BIA has so much control over the lives on reservations, and it micromanages reservations. It's not like the BIA was sort of a distant Washington bureaucracy that Indians on reservations can ignore. They directly control and micromanage life on the reservations. Perhaps the most mind-blowing bureaucratic problem I've ever read about in Washington is the problem that's called fractionation of Indian lands. This problem has been going on for over a century now. We may finally have a solution in sight about that problem, but it's a really remarkable and complex problem that Congress has known about for a century now and has not solved. Let me just make a few comments about the lack of economic development on reservations. Naomi covers this in detail in her book. What's remarkable is the number of different sort of basic institutional problems on reservations that we need to solve here to get some growth and prosperity on reservations. As Naomi talks about, there's the property socialism problem. If everyone owns tribal lands, then no one owns tribal lands. And as Naomi discussed, you know, people won't invest unless they have secure individual title to property, which they don't now on reservation lands. There's the fractionation problem, which I mentioned. There's large chunks of Indian lands that are, frankly, they're too complex to use, to lease out, to sell, or to develop because of this fractionation problem. There's BIA inefficiency. Every sort of economic transaction, a sale, a lease, probate, all kinds of transactions that have to go through the BIA bureaucracy, and they're very slow and inefficient. There's barriers to energy and resources development on Indian lands. President Trump says he's going to do something about that. We'll see whether he does. There's tribal government inefficiency. We've heard a little bit about that. There's a monopoly problem on reservations. Tribal governments operate some businesses, so you know that means they probably don't want individual entrepreneurial Indians to start competing businesses. Tribes invest in boondoggles, just like the federal government invests in things like Solyndra. Tribal governments have their own boondoggle problems. Trust land is tax exempt, and that creates a big barrier to economic development as well. Trust land can be converted to so-called fee simple land, in other words, to a structure that creates individual ownership, but there's a tax incentive to do so because fee simple land is subject to property taxation. So you see this in a lot of ways in many different cases, and I think some of the other panelists touched on this, that you know all this land is held in trust, and there's a disincentive to move it over toward individual ownership. And there's the impartial justice problem. Outside businesses are often deterred to invest on reservation land because they're worried that if there's contract disputes, there may not be impartial justice. And on the flip side of that, Indians are often suspicious, rightly so, if you look at history, of outside investors coming onto reservations and investing there. There's the welfare state problem that Naomi touched on. Any type of welfare creates disincentive problems for the recipients. There's crime rates. There's the fact that young entrepreneurial Indians will probably leave reservations rather than staying at home to build reservations. A lot of reservations are in isolated areas. That creates an economic problem as well. There's just such an enormous list of problems here, and the thing that really distresses, I think, anyone who looks at these policy issues is that Congress often does not focus on these fundamental problems. Naomi has a really nice quote on page 180 in her book where she talks about the problem that many politicians just focus on the pork aspect and they don't think about making fundamental reforms. I think the fundamental reforms have to start with individual property rights. But you know we can't impose a solution on reservations top down. We sort of tried that before in the past, and it was rejected and didn't work. The problem has to come a partnership between Washington and the tribes to develop perhaps new types of constitutions on reservations that enshrine individual property rights. That's the only way I think we're going to get long-term growth and development. Again, thanks a lot, Robert.
Sure.
It's a great panel.
Naomi, coming back to you and then the chairman, what would be like the number one or two things you'd like to see President Trump do, and maybe one or two things that Congress could do? I mean, what is doable within the administration as opposed to require congressional action?
Well, I think I would actually start local. I mean, I think that the lowest hanging fruit is really educational reform because it can be done on the state level. And like I said, the states with some of the largest Indian populations have no charter school laws or voucher or tuition tax credits or anything like that. And I think just simply providing American Indians with options to get out of these failing schools. When I was on Pine Ridge, I actually talked to a couple of people who were part of a program, and it was not entirely clear to me who was funding this, but where they actually took parents from Pine Ridge and took them to some high-performing charter schools in Denver, just so they could see what a KIPP Academy looks like. And the parents I talked to were just blown away, because a lot of the kids who were being educated in Denver, English wasn't even their first language. And these kids were performing at such a high level compared to what these parents had access to for their own children. I think one of the problems of the geographic isolation of some of the reservations is simply
not knowing what the possibilities are. I mean, I you can compare rural poverty and urban poverty in a lot of different ways, but you know, if you live in the South Bronx, the chances are you get on the subway, you know, every day, you see people wearing suits going to jobs. You could grow up on Pine Ridge and there might be no one in your immediate family who is employed, who has graduated from high school, who is sober. I mean, these are just the realities. I think that urban poverty, just at least you're exposed to what the options are. And so that's why I say education reform, I think just, you know, bringing more of that on a local level would be the first place to start. You know, on a federal level, I think what the congressman is doing and just starting to roll back some of the BIA's power. Like I said, you have no idea just the day-to-day involvement of BIA officers in people's everyday economic transactions. We just have to get them out of it. It's not the way adults in America live. I think that the larger property rights question is really the hardest question here. And I haven't seen, you know, the practical step-by-step solution except what I was pointing to in Canada, which I think does, you know, it does have a very similar system that we have here. And one of the nice things about this First Nations Property Ownership Act that I mentioned is that it actually gives tribes the option of opting in. You can say, oh no, we don't want real property ownership. We want to, you know, keep our socialist system, whatever. That's totally fine. But for the tribes that really want to take control of their own economic and political destiny, this offers them a way forward. And I think that that's what we need to be doing.
Mr. Chairman, did you have a high priority list of things that the new administration and you and Congress want to try to get done?
Yeah, unfortunately. Let me talk philosophically for the first time. Whatever we come up with our strategy and our approach, hopefully it is not going to be done by executive order. simply that our system of government was established, as convoluted as it is, to provide a stable form of government that didn't have wide swings of policy back and forth. Whatever is done by executive order, if it's going to be undone by executive order, it means there's going to be that swing from back and forth again. So I was not happy with the last president who said he'd go around Congress with his phone and his telephone. I don't want this new administration to go around Congress with tweeting. And I say that as the only person in Congress who has a Twitter account, and I have never tweeted a single character in my life, nor will I. But I don't want those swings coming back and forth. If you actually come to Congress to try and do something statutorily, that gives a stability in the process so people know what they can expect in the future and not delegate presidential elections to a life and death struggle because you realize it's going to be done or it's going to be undone or it's going to be redone again. There's value in the structure we simply had to do. So whatever we do, I hope comes from the legislature. And I do have to admit, as a couple of you have said, Congress has been really crappy about taking this responsibility on. It is much easier for us to have grand ideas than to take the time to come up with the details of a program. Yeah. But coming up with congressional details is what has to take place. And I also admit, because some of you in here I've had in my office talking to me about the philosophy of what we're trying to do, at some point we have to realize, what is our actual goal of what we are attempting to do? And that's why I like the book, because you're focusing on those. Some of them are actually pushing us back to policies that have failed in the past, but there's a different concept and with a different paradigm. But I appreciate that invitation, and sometimes it's so easy for us to say, oh, let's BIA do it, and we don't have to deal with the details of that. That gives an excessive amount of authority and ability to unelected bureaucrats, and if you don't like what their decision is, there is no way of going around it. That's the brilliance of that nasty thing called politics. If you have every 2 years, I'm up for election, which means whether I like it or not, I have to listen to people. Bureaucrats don't have to do that. That's why if people are going to be heard, it's got to be through the legislative process, not through an executive administrative process.
Keith, I want to ask you, one of the things that Naomi covers a lot in the book about charters and education reform, and she has a whole sort of a section on Teach for America's experience on reservation schools, is this pushback that does occur from a Native American community about from people coming from outside and trying to provide educational resources there. Could you let me know how do you see that, and what can those who want to bring better options in schools to this community do to make that work and make that go over?
Yeah, it's a great question. There's pushback in that if you take a look at the history, which Naomi does well in the book, you had non-Native people who forced policy on Natives for a lot of years. So when it comes to non-Native people coming and wanting to help educationally, or whether it was charter legislation, there's still historical, you know, still the historical straight arm that you get because of the history of the BIA and the BIE and who was in control of the, you know, those, the reins on that, which was a lot of times non-Native people. So you still historically have that. And it's complicated and complex when you take a look at this issue in Indian country. But I say this respectfully, if you take a look at the schools, we have in the BIE roughly 124 tribally controlled schools and about 59 BIE operated, which means the tribe run 124 of the schools with local school boards, and the Bureau of Indian Education operates 59. And when I was in the BIE, and again, I say this respectfully, if you took a look how school boards did with tribally run schools, it wasn't very effective. You had a lot of mismanagement. Those schools happened to do poorer than a lot of schools that were state-run schools, which are oftentimes operated by non-Native people. And that's a hard thing to say when you take a look at Indian country, but that is the truth. You had school boards who would spend on individual school board members anywhere from $70,000 to $80,000 a year on school board members for travel and conferences and wherever else they would go. And the truth is, in my opinion, that in Indian country, people use places like the local school board to build their political capital to be able to run eventually for tribal council. It's a great place to give jobs. It's a great place to help your constituency to eventually run for a different political office that's going to get you elected higher. So you look at folks like Teach for America, who I think have done a really nice job of coming and serving disadvantaged communities. They're going to get pushback because of history. You're also looking at, in Indian country, schools, like for me as an Indian person, to go and be a superintendent or teacher in Indian country in a tribally run school. The minute you make somebody mad who's in a political position, you can count that you're going to be run out of your position. So there are just a number of issues. And Teach for America, again, I'll say there's a lot of non-Native educational places in Teach for America, one of them, that are bringing extraordinary people to disadvantaged areas to serve them, especially in math and science and language arts. But the political divide is so deep and the longstanding issues are so deep that oftentimes that's what gets pushed aside.
Robert, I just wanted to add one thing. The problem is also exacerbated by the poor economic situation. You have to imagine you're living in a community where there are almost no jobs. And so suddenly becoming the fourth grade teacher is a plum position. And if your uncle is the tribal chief, you're in. I mean, so the corruption, there's so much more opportunity and incentive for corruption because there is no private sector economy. And the other thing I just wanted to add is, we haven't talked a lot about them, but Catholic schools are the other thing that, you know, you have a number, you know, throughout different reservations of Catholic schools. And obviously, again, there is this history there where, you know, they were, some of them were engaged in forced assimilation. These Catholic schools, the ones that I visited, are run entirely by American Indians. They are not white people who are coming in, but the attitude among the tribal leadership toward them is still the same. It's still based on their impression of what these schools were like 40 years ago. So even if the principal and all of the teachers are Native, that doesn't matter. That's the attitude is still the same, unfortunately.
So Chris, I want to bring you in on a topic that is also covered in the book very well, and that is this this annuity practice where certain Native American people receive a cash transfer for just being, and the incentive and the effect that it has on work rates and behavior. Is it a good example of how maybe a universal benefit might not work?
You know, The problem with the annuities and the tribes that have a lot of gaming income is the same as sort of the general welfare incentive problem, or it's the same as federal government providing corporate welfare. You know, corporations become dependent on it, and it, you know, affects their behavior in unproductive ways. I think the same is true, unfortunately, with gaming. I want to go back to a little bit about what the congressman talked in his talk about federalism, and I think, you know, there is one push here that I think you know, that would be consistent with what Republicans on Capitol Hill are pushing for more generally, and that is the idea of federalism and block grants. And I think that is an area where we could reform these flows of money to the tribes, BIE and BIA. There is some block granting now, but it you know, it does seem to me that we could go further in that direction, give the tribes broad chunks of money. There's still the problem of tribal governance, of course, so we need transparency, we need good governance reforms along with these big block grants, but I think that is the way to go.
And Naomi, just to reiterate on this one, and something you said, which I really liked, the statistics here, which we haven't really hit too hard, we don't have charts and graphs, are really awful. I mean, the poverty rates are terrible, the child abuse rates are awful. So when you talk about something like block grants, which often gets a reaction in Washington of great fear, because it's untested and new, and what will happen. In this case, trying something different is worth doing, because whatever we're doing now isn't working. So it really is a good argument for blowing it up and starting fresh.
Right. We do need transparency, though, because as I think a number of the panelists have discussed, the interests of tribal leadership are not necessarily the same as individuals who live on reservations. And so it does seem to me we need to reform. The governance needs to be reformed in some way, such that individual tribal members can, either through petition or referenda or something, can make their voice heard about constitutional change on the reservation, about educational change, and all these issues, rather than just sort of having the tribal governments dominate the process.
Because right. If we're going to have a federal oversight of these grants and ensuring transparency and ensuring lack of corruption, we have to do a better job at that than we're doing now. I mean, the incidences that I describe in the book, and we haven't gotten into this that much. Is these abuse questions that have come up. There have been cases where whistleblowers have been fired who work for the federal government, who have said, no, this is what's going on there, and the federal government said, we don't want to hear about it. So I think that there is definitely a problem, and you could trace it to cultural sensitivity or just a patronizing attitude that we shouldn't really call them out when we see tribal corruption. But if we're going to engage in this kind of block grant process, the federal government has to be ready to step in and say, no, we want to see what's going on, where this money is going.
So, Naomi, I'm going to press one little further on this cash transfer, because an issue of importance to me.
Absolutely.
But you cover it well in the book. Explain a little bit what the effects of that are on work, on family, on drug use. Yeah. And what did you see?
So the tribe that I specifically chose to look at, like I mentioned when I was talking earlier, were the Senecas. Like I said, they earned this $1 billion off of their casinos in upstate New York. They have one in Buffalo, then one just outside of Buffalo. And in a sense, this could be your dream. If you have some vision that the problem with poverty is that people don't have enough money, this is it. We could just drop $1 billion on this small community and see what happens. So now, that being said, they still don't have property rights, so there are other things that are preventing them from, say, using this money in ways that some people who have the universal basic income might. So I just want to add that caveat. But basically, when you turn 21 on the Seneca Reservation, somebody hands you a check for $30,000. Prior to that, you've probably not had a very good education. The schools that surround the Seneca territory are some of the worst in New York State, which is saying something, because we obviously have some pretty bad schools in the inner city areas as well. But somebody hands you this check for $30,000. And even if you talk to the Seneca tribe leaders, they will say the best case scenario is someone buys a new truck. The worst case is they spend it on drugs or alcohol. These kids will walk into a store and just hand someone $100 and not expect change. I mean, it just doesn't, it's like lottery winners. The studies of lottery winners that show you're no better off, 5 years later because you've blown off. You have no
The incentives to save and invest are not there when you have not earned the money. So that's, you know, sort of where you start. And then you get these regular annuities. So the older members of the tribe get more. But everyone, you know, when I did the research, you know, a few years ago, everyone was getting $7,000 or $8,000. It's probably closer to 10 now because the Senecas are there. The leadership is investing the money. So it's growing. And they're also aware that, you know, gambling is starting to become, you know, harder and harder to make a living at because it's been opened up to more and more people. So they're trying to get people. They're opening up small business incubators. Nobody's there. I mean, why would I bother? Nobody is saving the money to go to college. Even on the tribal leadership level, and this was shocking to me, because I said, well, now the tribe has all this money. Why don't you go invest in the schools? And they said, well, you know, we've helped them fund a couple of more security officers at the local public schools. I mean, that's what $1 billion buys you? The healthcare system, I think, is slightly better than it was. But in terms of the individual economic prosperity, achievement, aspiration for saving, starting businesses, you really don't see much of an effect. And in some cases, you see more crime as a result of this. There's these cases, these horrible cases of elder abuse, you know, people taking the annuity checks of the elders in the tribe. I mean, it's disgusting. But, you know, but I think that the overall lesson, at least that I walked away with, was that the dropping money out of a plane plan is not the one to go with.
I would say quickly on that topic, because Naomi touches on this in the book, and I've regularly told folks that the difference between the Seneca and, if you talk about Rosebud, Pine Ridge, Lower Brule, Crow Creek, Cheyenne River, whatever, those are five of the reservations in South Dakota. You're talking about isolated, deep, and generational poverty. So we mention those words a lot, but you think about isolation. It's just off. It's off the beaten path. We like to say to people in South Dakota, have you ever been south of the Interstate 90? Which means, you know, that's Indian country down there. But most people have never been to Indian country unless they've just passed through. But you're talking about extreme isolation. You're talking about deep poverty, as Naomi says, Shannon County, which is the county she references, is the second poorest county in the country. People live on 65. You know, people say to me all the time, how do people live on $6,500, $7,000? Yes, subsidized housing. When I grew up, it was commodity programs. I think we call it food assistance programs. There's just enough, and people have learned how to move in together with 20 or 30 people living in a home and have commodity programs, subsistence housing, and learn how to just exist under that. And it's been going on so long that it's very different to think any different because of the longstanding issues. And as Naomi says, you see this in any country, and I say this respectfully again, the ingenuity and innovative and creative part of life has been pretty squelched for a long time because government has provided. So,
can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
How do young people on reservations think about, you know, staying or leaving? What goes through their mind?
And that's a tough issue because, you know, Chris, people leave and go to college. They come home. I call it the crab mentality. If you try to crawl out and you try to go somewhere, we're going to try to pull you back in. Right. And there's a lot of that exists. And it's really tough for kids who grow up 18 years at home and on a reservation and then leave to go to a university setting. And it's lonely. It's tough on Indian kids to do that. And it's easy to come home and when you get home and feel comfortable back at home. And the other issue, and I think Naomi mentions this in the book, is just money management. I mean, you leave, you've got, you know, your Pell Grant, your loans, and you got your tribal money help. But kids can have no concept of financial literacy or how to manage finances and can spend that money within a month of school. And then you're sitting there going, all right, I've spent my money, and now what do I do? Maybe I haven't even bought books yet. And back home we go.
Mr. Chairman.
The crab mentality, I mean, there is a cultural problem here. I mean, I tell people, like, it's if you imagine the typical immigrant family, the native family is sort of the opposite. The immigrant family is like, I came here, I sacrificed everything, now you get the hell out of this bad neighborhood, you go to better schools, I don't care if you live across the country, it doesn't matter to me. For native parents, it's much more of this feeling of, if you leave here, even if it's to go to college, even if it's to make yourself better, you've somehow betrayed the community. And I've talked to young people who feel like this is there's like a guilt issue going on if they leave. And so I think they're definitely not preparing them financially because I don't think they're even preparing them, you know, mentally for this break either.
So I've got one more question, and maybe two, but Mr. Chairman, I want to ask you about the natural resources question, because this has come up. The property is valuable. It has resources that the country, there is opportunity there. How will we know that Native American lands have been freed up for that kind of development? And what do we need to make sure happens so that it's done in the right way in the next couple of years? Or are you skeptical that it's going to happen?
I'm not quite sure how I can answer the question, because it's the same question that deals with all federal lands, whether they are Native American lands or not. The only way you can actually do that is by freeing up the regulations so that people who were there can actually move in there. And it also allows us to establish, we have to establish where economic development can take place and where recreation can take place and guarantee that it happens. So the biggest problem I have with any kind of federal lands for energy development is industry does not know where they can actually expect to go and where they can get a lease and where they can get the approvals in time and where they can get the ability of corridors to transport their product out of it. And until you can guarantee that and not make it subject to the whim of an administrator in an agency, you have the problems. And the Native Americans who are trying to develop their resources have the same problem on anybody else in federal lands.
So it's a broader issue than just Native American issues. Yes.
And you know, history is important to all of these issues. Part of the history here is that for many decades, the BIA sided often with outside energy and mineral companies to come in and use Indian land and underpay Indian the royalties that they really deserved and give worse contracts than other private landowners would get. So I can imagine there's suspicion on the part of some tribes and some reservations about, you know, outsiders coming in and expropriating without them getting their full fair market value.
Yes. Quickly. I'll do this quickly.
Absolutely.
The Cobell settlement obviously dealt with fractionalized land.
Right.
And paying back of mismanaged natural resources over the last 100 plus years. But yet I would say this on the fractionalized land, which was buying back, which my mom was part of. And Naomi mentions this in the book. I can't remember who it was, but got a $2.46 check, you know, each year. My mom was one of those. I remember when our check would come and she'd get her, you know, $2 check on the land she owned from fractionalization. Cobell was supposed to, you know, assist and help with that. I think there needs to be a deep study on whether Cobell is going to be successful or it isn't, or maybe it already isn't. But again, the land went where? Into trust. You know, rather than that land helping people be able to buy land and individually own it, it goes back into trust for the tribe. And again, I know it isn't popular, but we're not going to get where we need to go in any country until we have freedom, autonomy, and the ability to buy land and own it and create wealth.
And that also applies the ability of actually encouraging competition. So what you're talking about with schools, you can say with a whole lot of districts. But what you need to do is make sure there's competition there so people have some kind of choices. And that when we deal with Native American policy, we don't base it on what has happened in the past. We got to build forward to make sure that you can go forward and give people some options and choices, but they can get those choices themselves.
Okay, let's see what we've got in the audience for questions. And let's see, over there, this gentleman raising his hand right there. Do we have a microphone? You've got the microphone in your hand already. There you go.
Steve Williams.
Does that mean you brought the microphone with you?
I just wanted to ask all of you, but I guess particularly the chairman.
It's not on.
Well, just
I'm not speaking loud enough?
There you go.
Okay.
A little better.
Just have to pretend it isn't there. I wanted to ask the whole group, but particularly, I guess, the chairman, is there any serious prospect of legislation that would enable Indians to obtain private property rights in the land that they now own, I guess, as trust beneficiaries? And I ask with great anxiety because I know a lot of Indian rights lawyers who regard the Dawes Act as a great sin, and particularly the private property rights aspect of it. So I'd be interested in what the political field looks like.
No. I'm sorry, no one is working on that yet, but what the book raises are those questions. And you actually put it in the context there of what has happened in the past. Are we going to repeat it, or are we going to do it in a different approach to it? So no one is working on that now, but over the next couple of years, 2 to 4 years, I hope that is an approach that's going to be explored, because it's a crux, it's a key element to if you're going to make major significant changes in allowing greater flexibility and greater autonomy. So it's a question that has to be asked. No one is working on it right now, I am aware.
And Keith, you spent time in the belly of the beast, in the federal bureaucracy. Do you see hope for this property rights legislation or opportunity?
The right terms need to be used. And I heard early in this administration, somebody said privatize Indian land. And of course, everybody went crazy. Because again, that means taking land off the trust rolls. And it means loss of land for the tribe, which we all are clear. I think if you understand the Dawes Act at all, it took almost 2/3 of reservation land in the Dawes Act. I think if you read the Dawes Act and you really do study it, I think Henry Dawes had a good concept, and it was a good idea. But then it moves in to the bureaucratic process, and it gets mismanaged, and it ends up, a boondoggle.
Right.
And today, tribes will go back, as I've said several times, to history, and they're going to be very skeptical of any new possible legislation that will talk about privatization or land being taken off trust rolls. So it's a touchy point to discuss and discuss well with tribes and Indian leaders.
It is worth going back to the Dawes Act and actually looking at what it did, because it didn't actually grant full property rights. It said, you can have this land, we'll think about it for 25 years before we actually give you full ownership of it. So imagine someone gave you a piece of land and said, here, for the next 25 years, you can kind of sit on it, but you don't really own it, so you can't sell it to anyone, you can't really develop on it. So I mean, people talk about the Dawes Act as if it was full private property, but it wasn't. And I highly recommend Terry Anderson at PERC has done a great work on this. And he even argues that the expansion of the BIA was in part the result of bureaucrats finding a way to kind of occupy themselves by sort of saying you can have a little bit of control of this land, a little bit of control of that land, and that actually was the reason that we have such a big BIA today.
Yes, sir, in the back.
Good afternoon. My name is Todd Wiggins. I'd have a quick series of questions for neophytes to the top general topic of the plight of Native Americans economically. Perhaps you may have prefaced this, or you may have some statistics in your book, but can you address what general unemployment or employment figures are across the board? Also, how many Native Americans statistically voted in national elections, et cetera, or have participants or representatives in Congress, et cetera? And then also, how many of them are involved in own businesses statistically relative to the general population, and how many of them have gone to secondary schools or have various backgrounds in economic development, et cetera, relative to the general population?
Naomi, want to give a quick or
the unemployment rate, Nash? I mean, it's really it's very hard to sort of. I don't know what the unemployment rate nationally is, I should say that. I think you could go to different reservations and find unemployment rates, like I said, higher than 80%. So I do want to make the distinction between American Indians who are living on reservations and those who are not. I think there are about 2 million people, according to the census, who identify as Native Americans, and about 1 million of them are living on reservations. The million who are living on reservations are much worse off for all of the reasons that we've just been describing in terms of the policies. The education rates, like I said, the education and the employment rates are worse than for just about any other racial or ethnic group in the country. I think nationally is about a 67% high school graduation rate. If you go to Pine Ridge, it's about 49%, I think. At some of the BIE schools, it's even lower than that. There was just a lawsuit filed this week by a tribe near the Grand Canyon. Their students were performing in the first percentile, one, for reading and the third percentile for math. And they're suing the federal government and the BIE for not providing them with a sufficient education. I don't know what the voting rates are. Maybe the congressman knows. And I don't know how many natives are in Congress either, if that was your question. So,
okay, over here. Yes, ma'am, right there.
Katrin Kuiper, Philanthropy Roundtable. Apart from any potential policy change, what could donors and nonprofits do to help in this situation?
Yeah, that's a great question from the standpoint of, you know, I'll take South Dakota, for example. I live in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. It's a pretty darn well-to-do community, and a number of folks will come through me to have conversations with our higher end financial folks in Sioux Falls, and they're reluctant to put money into the reservation under the current structure that we've all been talking about because they consider it a black hole. And in South Dakota, we don't have charter legislation, which I have pushed for in South Dakota. I said, you don't have to do charter legislation for the whole state, but consider doing charter legislation on Indian lands. Because again, what I said earlier, we're doing an unfortunately really poor job of educating Indian kids. Now there's a litany of reasons for that. Socioeconomic over time, I mean, you're talking about broken homes, dad's not around, very little money in the home, drug and alcohol abuse, physical sexual abuse. There are all kinds of issues that go to that. But nonprofits and donors and people that want to help, it's really hard to pull off because tribes are going to be pushed back on that as well because they want tribal sovereignty and I want you know, the tribes to be able to operate and do anything in any country. So there are really some deep issues that go again to being able to do that. You can take Teach for America, who's gone out and served as a nonprofit in Indian country. In South Dakota now, they're getting a lot of pushback at this point. Probably been in the state 8, 9, 10 years. Providing high-end folks. But once you get in and if they see success or they see wanting more, you know, control or more of a voice, then you're going to get a strong pushback. But in South Dakota, and I would final say, and I'd go back to what I said initially, people consider it a black hole because of the longstanding issues.
I would say the Catholic schools seem to me, they're the only sort of independently run institution. And even they sort of get pressure that, you know, some tribal leadership wants to like impose some crazy tax on all of their teachers or something like that just to try to keep them out of it. But the two schools that I visited were Red Cloud, which is on Pine Ridge, and St. Labre, which is in between the Crow and the Northern Cheyenne reservations in Montana. They're both completely independently run, all run by Native American leaders. And they're both, I think St. Labre is totally tuition free and offers like 5-day boarding for students who live too far away if they want. And I think Red Cloud charges maybe like $100 a semester, and if you can't afford it, they'll waive that. So I think, and those schools are performing infinitely better than any school on either reservation. So, you know, obviously, you know, there's a small number of these across the country, but I certainly think that, you know, for bang for your buck, that's where you can get it in these places.
Yeah, and I'd say quickly. I mean, not clearly, we all know, right? The divide in America is pretty deep and wide. And I would say the divide in Indian country between Indian people and non-natives and state and federal government is even wider. So it makes it real difficult.
Yes, sir. Wait for the mic. Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Mitsuo Nakai, a Japan native U.S. citizen. I'm feeling devastated. This is my first experience listening to these people regarding American Indians, reservations, and so forth.
A question. We want a question.
Okay. It reminds me of Asian histories when the Japanese people went to Japanese island. There were natives lived there and chased them up to the mountain. And when Chiang Kai-shek went to Taiwan, they had natives there too. And somehow they did a good job of doing away with the reservation type of system. So my question is there any way we can do away with the reservation system? Because it's not doing well. So that's my question.
Okay. Are we reservations here to stay?
Well, I mean, I think the issue has come up a number of times that, I mean, the tribal governments, and often I'm sure many Indians feel very strongly about the reservations. They many times, you know, over two centuries, the you know, the federal government, of course, stole their lands and their minerals and all kinds of things from them and their freedom. And so I imagine they feel that this is what they have left. And so I don't think that's a policy approach that's going to get much traction. Right. It seems to me you want a bottoms-up movement from reservations about changing their own constitutions, again, by, you know, by processes that they get individuals involved through petitions and through referenda and that sort of thing. That seems to me the way you want to make institutional reform.
I think the only theoretical proposal that has been, and again, I interviewed a man who used to be on the Federal Civil Rights Commission, and he said, you know, one thing you could just do is make all the reservations into states. And that would sort of address all the things that we've been saying about federalism, which is give the tribal leaders the same kinds of block grants, the same kinds of autonomy. And that would come, obviously, with a huge number of other problems, I think. But I think that gets at sort of the right approach, even if we're not going to constitutionally make that happen. I think in terms of the autonomy and the freedom and the federalism, that's what we should be looking more toward.
And it will engender a competition.
It also clarifies, this is something we haven't talked about enough, it clarifies the rights of American Indians as American citizens. Because although we are subjects to the laws of the state of New York or New Jersey, we are also guaranteed certain rights as American citizens. And I feel like sometimes in these discussions we've been having, whether it's about the Dakota Pipeline or any of these other issues, we throw around these terms, you know, sovereign nations. And I think there is a great deal of confusion in the court system for a variety of reasons about what it means to be both a resident of a reservation, American Indian, and also be an American citizen and what that means for your protections as well.
I'd quickly say if I could.
Yes, go ahead.
Chris was talking about a bit. I would say, how do you design policy, legislation that people could opt into, where you could define what that would look like, and then you have an opt-in option that's presented to Indian Country. Don't have to do it if you don't want to, but here's what policy could look like, and it'd be designed.
And if they opted in and results turned out to be better, that would become discussed, and it might bring others along.
Right. The statistics, accountability, and research needs to be a part of what we do going forward.
Yes, sir.
Hi, my name's Paul Moorhead. I'm an attorney representing tribes here in Washington. And I want to thank you for a provocative panel. My question is for Chris. Almost 25 years ago, Congress enacted two tax credits, one a wage credit and one an accelerated depreciation for property placed in service on Indian lands. And I'm curious, from your perch as a tax person, whether that's had any measurable impact in terms of attracting private sector entities that would benefit from these two credits, as would the host communities, obviously.
Those are credits under the federal income tax?
They are.
Yeah, I mean, I guess the problem is we don't have very many for-profit businesses on reservations run by folks by outside, so I can't imagine it has that much effect, because it probably doesn't affect much economic activity. But I'm not an expert on those two particular credits. I think there is. I raised the issue of the property tax exemption for trust land. That strikes me as a real problem that has been raised here, that there is this disincentive to move trust land over to individual fee simple ownership. And I don't know what the solution to that is, but that's a real sort of hidden barrier, it seems to me.
So occasionally I'm on panels of this kind, and afterwards I sometimes kick myself because there was always that point I didn't get to make and I wanted to make. So I want to give each of you a chance. Is there something about this topic that you haven't said that you want to make sure you say before we close? So I'll start with you, Naomi, and I'll come right down here to finish with Keith.
I guess I would go, the congressman offered this great quote from this woman in the resource commissioner in his state, and I do think that she's, it perfectly exemplifies what the problem is. I mean, Americans have this
very romanticized notion of what American Indians are and what they want and how they want to live. And you know, I'm a reporter. I visited a bunch of these communities and I talked to people on the ground, and the people that I spoke to, for the most part, wanted what all of us want. They want a good education for their kids. They want a way to make money. You know, they want a decent house. They don't want to be living with a tarp in the winter in South Dakota. And for me, the idea that we are basing all of our policy on some romanticized notion of how all Indians want to live in some kind of environmentalist, socialist utopia is crazy. And I really wish that we would finally do justice and, you know, and extend to them the same rights that we all enjoy as American citizens.
Mr. Chairman?
I think I've done enough damage already. But to me, the most compelling is the idea that Indian country is not a monolithic concept. That's what you were talking about.
Right.
We have to incorporate that in the way we come up with policy. I don't think we've done a good job of that in the past.
Chris?
I looked on the Senate Select Committee on Indian Affairs website this morning, and two pieces on the top right-hand corner that they're highlighting were two individual pieces of legislation that would be two new different types of subsidy for Indian country. To me, that is not the right way to go. We shouldn't be spending our time creating new subsidies. We should be thinking about broad-based fundamental institutional reform.
I would say that, first of all, I want to thank, you know, again, Naomi for taking on this complicated and complex issue, the congressman to be here, Chris to be here. And it's worthwhile. What is the correct policy going forward to make a difference, whether it's Indian health service, Indian education, business ownership, land ownership? These are critical issues that are right now far from where we need them to be. I live in a state where we just had to have two hospitals shut down, Pine Ridge and Rosebud, due to improper care and just poor operation. You look at the BIE system, it's a nightmare. Bottom line, I lived it, I was in it, I left it because I don't like to say, because I do have hope. I didn't have hope in that system. I mean, I'm sitting there looking at it going, I don't know how you move this bureaucratic, you know, Titanic to get to a spot where it can have a positive effect. And the same thing I see in any country with the extreme unemployment, low income rates, all of it are necessary and critical going forward for us to have an opportunity. And I say us as Indian people. And that's a tough conversation to have. Because if there were tribal leaders in here right now and sitting here, they'd be pounding the table and upset about a number of things that were said. And that makes folks like the congressman oftentimes, and I say this highly respectfully, get weak-kneed. I mean, it's so
not
hard.
Not this congressman.
It's so hard to listen to and hear, you know, the diverse things that tribal leaders think and what they want, that it makes it hard to take on the topic. So I just want to thank folks for sitting in. I hope we can find something in the short term that can make a difference for Indian people and kids. And education is critical. I'll say this lastly. I grew up in a community. When I moved off the reservation, there were probably two handfuls of us in the school system, 1% of them, 30 years ago. Today, 40% Native kids in that school. More and more Native people are sending their kids off the reservation in buses to go to public schools where they believe their kids can get a better education. And that hurts people to do that off of their reservations, but they have hope there in some of those schools. And those are hard things to talk about, that your tribal school is doing so poorly that we're going to bus our kids 30 or 40 miles because we believe they're going to have a better chance out there than staying here at home.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for being here, and thanks to the panel. Thank you very much. You were great. You really were.